Okay, so let's start with the presentation today. Streaming data analysis with ksqlDB. So first of all, let's take a quick look at the agenda that I prepared today. So first of all, we will have an introduction about ksqlDB. So we will understand the key concepts about this technology. After that, we will see several use cases. And we will go deeper in data quality reconciliation of use case. Later, we will see the takeaways, and we will have some time for questions. OK, so introduction to ksqlDB. So here we can see a streaming pipeline. We are consuming from a source DB. We are doing kind of transformation, and we are producing something in the target DB. How we are assuring the data quality here? How we can assure, OK, the data that I'm producing is exactly what I'm consuming? Well, in this case, we are talking about databases. So you could say, OK, I could run queries against the target database, queries against the source database, and I could do the comparison, no? It wouldn't be harder. But what happens if, in case of having a source DB, we have Kafka topics or RabbitMQ queues? In that case, it's difficult, no, to perform the reconciliation, to know that I am not losing data. Telling to my customer that they can trust in the data that I'm producing because it's exactly the same as I am getting in the input. So now we are gonna see how ksqlDB can help us with this, no? Okay, what is ksqlDB? It's the streaming SQL engine for Kafka engine that you can use to perform streaming tasks. ksqlDB differs from other streaming technologies that, like Apache Spark or Apache Flink, that you don't have to know languages like Java, Python, or something like that. Just running a few SQL sentences, you can build your own streaming application. Also, in a single cluster, we have the Kafka connectors, we have all the streaming processing, and we have the query serving. So we can use ksqlDB to get the results. So now we are gonna see some key concepts about ksqlDB. One would be about the collections. We have two different types of collections. One would be the strings, which are immutable. So basically, we are always appending data to that log. So if you think about this in a database, it could be a table without any primary key, where I can just be only appending data. And we have also the collections like table, which are mutable. So every time that I get a new record, it's gonna be an insert, but if I get an update, I will update that record, and if I get a deletion, I will delete that record. It's something mutable. So these two type of collections are key, no? When we are gonna do something with ksqlDB because they have kind of restrictions. So let's see now the difference between between a string and table. So in case that a first event arrives with key one, in case of a string would be an insert, in case of a table, it could be an insert as well. Another event with key one arrives, in case of a string, as we said, we are always appending data. So it's gonna be an insert. And in case of table, it will cause an update on a table. An event with a key and a value null, if that arrives, in case of a string, exactly the same, we are gonna insert because we are always appending all the information. And in case of the table, it will cause a deletion. And at the last, if an event with a key null arrives, in case of streams, saying it will be an insert, and in case of table, it will be ignored because basically we don't know the key, so we cannot do anything with that record. Okay. Another key concept are the push queries and pull queries. So push query is just that you can subscribe to a query, so you are going to be notified every time that a record is matching with the conditions that you have in the query. This is really useful to have something real-time and reactive. No? It's going to react, and you are going to get a new result every time that an event is matching with what we have in the query. The other type of queries, it would be the pull query. That is basically the same as an usual relational database, where you can perform a query, and you are going to get a result. But you have to wait for that result, something synchronous. OK, so now that we have seen some concepts which are going to be important to understand the different use cases, we can go deeper in the use cases and see how ksqlDB can help us to build all of this. So the first case would be materialized cache. A materialized cache is basically an application or a paradigm where you are spending a lot of resources to store the information in a database or in a cache to be quickly consumed. So all the work that we are investing is to put all that information in a format that is going to be easily consumed by the client. So here we can see that we have, for instance, a MySQL database, Kafka Connect using division, so we are going to ingest all the changes using the chain data capture into Kafka. We will have a streaming processing. It could be Apache Flink or Spark, and we are dropping the results in a Kafka topic, and using Kafka Connect, we are updating Redis, so the user can query Redis. Is this a valid approach? I think so, no? It's a valid approach. I've seen tons of applications like this. But could we do this in an easier way? I think so, just using ksqlDB. Why? Because using ksqlDB, you are going to have all the embedded connectors. You can declare the connector directly in ksqlDB. You can do all the streaming processing using streaming and tables. And you can have your final tables as materialized view, so you can serve the queries from that materialized view, because ksqlDB offer a REST API. So let's see another use case. There could be a streaming ETL pipeline, where we can see that we are going to have two different databases, Postgres and MongoDB, using Kafka Connect, exactly the same, no? With division, we can track all the changes in the database. We are going to drop those changes into Kafka, and with another application, we will be able to produce an output in Kafka also, and using Kafka Connect, we can send that into Elasticsearch, so the user can consume that information. Is this a valid approach? It's a valid approach. But could we do this in a easier way? Exactly the same as we have seen before. So using ksqlDB, we could have the two different connectors defined in ksqlDB. We could do all the streaming processing, all the filtering, all the joinings, all the aggregation, and we can produce an output in a topic, and using another Kafka connector, we could sync also in Elasticsearch. So we have all the different capabilities just inside of ksqlDB. So now let's see another use case that would be an event-driven microservice that basically is going to react. It's a microservice that is going to react to different events. So here we can see that we are using Kafka Connect to ingest events. We have some stream processing that is finally triggering side effects. So I have here a streaming application that is handling also a state. You have to take care of that state because it's something ad hoc, we could say. Could we do this in an easier way? Yes, using ksqlDB, we could have all the connectors that we have seen. We could do all the streaming processing, and we could produce the specific event to be consumed from the different microservices and trigger the side effect that we prefer. So now that we have seen some common use cases, let's be focused on data quality reconciliation. So why is data quality needed? Data quality. So same way as we are assuring the quality at the different levels when we are developing an application, something like that, with unit testing, component testing, integration testing, performance testing, I think that is really important to assure the data quality because it is what you are producing for the end user, is the data points that you can offer to be consumed. So what happened? If we don't have, as we don't have control of the data source, we need to assure the quality because if you are producing an output that is not expected, you can always compare against the source and say, okay, I am producing this output because I am getting this input. So for that reason, data quality is needed. You are gonna have that insight. Also, it's important to measure the projection that we are gonna have in the repositories where we are storing the information in the final databases. And finally, developers can use this to validate future development. So as part of every new development, same way that we are adding more unit testing, we are adding coverage to the piece of code that we are developing, we are adding different test cases, we can add also those data quality checks. So we can check that the data that we are producing is the expected one. Also, as I said at the beginning, as we don't have control of the data source that we are ingesting, using data quality, we can know how close we are from an ideal state. Because with data quality, you can always have kind of thresholds, so you can see if the output of data that you are producing is exactly the same as what you are expecting. So now, we are gonna introduce the concept of reconciliation. Basically, reconciliation is to compare the target data against the source data. So, what this is useful because this ensures the consistency between different data sets. So, as I said, if you have an application that is transforming and doing an aggregation, you can compare that the same number of events that you are getting in the input is exactly the same as you are producing in the output. It's important to define several metrics when we are assessing the output that we are producing. So we are gonna see some common samples of data reconciliation, what would be the total numbers of rows that I am producing in a given period of time, or the total number of rows based on a given condition. Okay, so now I think that we have introduced all the different use cases, the technology, and also what is data quality and reconciliation. We can see a sample, step by step, that how we can use ksqlDB to assure the data quality. So let's take a quick look at this application. So we have the source database that could be MySQL, where we are gonna have customer and orders. And we are using Kafka Connect to ingest the information from the database into Kafka. And we are gonna have a streaming pipeline. It could be developed using Apache Flink, for instance. And we are gonna perform here an aggregation. So we are gonna aggregate all the customers per order, all the orders per customer. So we will have customers order fat in PostgreSQL. So, we could do a reconciliation application, a microservice using Spring Boot or a different technology, and basically it's gonna compare the metrics that we are gonna extract from the targets against the metrics that we can produce using ksqlDB. So, we are gonna be focused on this bit, how we can get metrics from ksqlDB. So this would be the first one. Customers per region. First of all, let's create a string, customers, over the Kafka topic customer using the value format abro. Okay, in this case, we are using abro because I am using also a schema registry so we can handle the different schema evolution. And also abro is a compressed format. So I think that it fits really good for this use case. So when we have this string created, we can create a table on top of that string where we could just grouping by region ID, we can count the distant emails. Email, it would be unique for the customer. So we can have the customers per region, the total number of customers per region. This is one of the scalar functions that, or the function that ksqlDB offers. We need to be careful when we are using, for instance, count distinct, because it's not exact, it's an approximation. It's using hyperlog. So it could have till 1 or 2% of differences. No? It's an approximation, so it's something that you have to consider. Anyway, every time that we are creating a data quality reconciliation application, we have to handle thresholds. No? So it's not just exactly the same, because you could have data delays or whatever. No? So they could be the first metric that we are going to create. Another metric, orders per customer. So saying we are going to create a string on top of the orders topic, where I am getting all the different changes using Kafka Connect. Saying I am using value format abro. So I can create a table, order per customer, just grouping by purchaser, accounting the number of rows, I will have the total orders. So they could be the second metric that I can use to compare what I am going to produce in the target, no? That is going to be Postgres. So the third metric that we are going to see is orders per region. This is a bit more difficult because you have seen in the sample at the beginning, we have two different streams, customers and orders. And in order to know the orders per region, the region is something that is coming from the customer stream. So for that reason, I need to perform a join. So let's see how, using ksqlDB, I can create a join. So now, using the customers stream that we have already created, I can do a group by customer ID. So I will have in a table all the customers. That is going to be in a table. I need to use, obviously, this aggregation function because I am grouping just by customer ID. So using this table, I'm joining with orders per customer. I am going to have order enrich, where I will have the information of the orders plus the information that is coming from the region. And on top of that, I can create another table, orders per region, where just grouping by region ID, I can sum the total number of orders. So finally, I will have orders per region. So let's review a bit what we have been doing. As I said, using Kafka Connect, we are ingesting the information into different topics in Kafka, and using different strings and table, I can create a string and different tables to produce metrics that I could use to compare against metrics that are going to come directly from the database. So let's see quickly a sample, a demo, with demo. So here, this would be ksqlDB. I can see that, for instance, customer per region, and I have, and this would be Postgres, the target. I can see customer per region. That the expected value is matching. No, I can do the same also for order per region. Also, as I said, I am using in this case ksqlDB CLI, no, the client that we have. But ksqlDB is accessible using REST API. You can just perform a query and you're going to get a result. Okay, another one. So for instance, we could even using a push query. This is a sample of push query because I am adding here emit changes. Using a push query, I could get how many customers have more than 5 orders. So as I said, it's something that is not a pull query, so I have to wait for the result. And using Postgres, I have the query over here. Let me see. 78, no? This could be just a simple query over the customer order fat. Okay, let's try now to farm some more items. Let's see if it works. So now I have 80. You have to see, as I left this push query running, now it's automatically updated, so it's 80. That is exactly the same value that I'm getting from Postgres now, no?